The Great Steppe, millenniums of events, hundreds of nomadic tribes and people. They lived, worked, made discoveries, conquered large tracts of lands and left us some mysteries. To learn more about it, watch a project called Enigma of the Great Steppe. Among these slaves, he was the youngest boy, very weak and looked the most helpless. However, all boys here were helpless. They were kidnapped, teared from home and parents, thrown into the cave half-starving to make them angrier. They had a long journey to make and no one was never to see his native land again. The youngest of the slaves was hungry, was feeling cold and very scared. And the premonition also played a role here. In a figurative sense, he had to die for his tribe and to rise for another nation. Soon, kidnapped boy will become a leader. Soon, his name will be connected to one of the unusual events in history of the Mamluks. They separated from Kanli tribe and moved to uninhabited lands, and that's why this tribe was called Kipchaks. This word means wild, deserted steppe. Their land was called Desht I Kipchak. The name of Kipchak tribe was mentioned in the works of different authors over 1,200 years ago. Over time, these nomads became a powerful tribe. The whole Great Steppe was named after them. The ethnographer Mashkur Jusupkopiev described this period as following. In the west, Sirdarya, in the east, Irtysh, in the south, Semirechye, in the north, Volga. The land between these four rivers was called Deshti Kipchak, where 92 sub-tribes of Kipchak were settled. But what did bring down Kipchaks from the top of the historical Olympus? What unenviable fate was prepared for some nomads, and what was the involvement of harem boys' generation here? In 1223, the Mongols defeated Kipchaks and the combined units of South Russian dukes near River Kalka. In 1237, having conquered the eastern and southern parts of Russia, Batu attacked Kipchaks. According to the Arab historian Rukhnadinna, discord between the two groups of Kipchaks led to an early success of the Mongols.
Момента покорения великой степи Дешти Кипчака монголами.
After Mongols' conquest of the Great Steppe, Deshti Kipchak, Kipchaks had a tragedy. The Mongols exterminated Kipchak aristocracy. Part of it joined the Mongols but lost their power and importance. The fate of the Khans was sad, they were killed.
Часть этой аристократии, разумеется, перешла на сторону монголов и каким-то образом влилась в их элиту.
Nomads were made a part of Mongolian military machine. Some Kipchaks tried to fight back, but they also were killed. Others could migrate over the Danube, make military alliances, start the military service under the Byzantine and the Hungarian rulers, move to the Caucasus and further.
Смогла откочевать за Дунай и заключить военные союзы и наняться на военную службу к византийскому правителю, к венгерскому.
A new page of Kipchak history started from this moment. Some of Kipchak boys were taken to the slave markets of Crimea and Egypt.
Часть из них, особенно, значит, мальчики, оказалась на невольничьих рынках Крыма и была продана и была, сказать, была продана в Египет.
In medieval Egypt, the slaves of the Turkic, Caucasian and other origins were called Mamluks, which means belonging to someone. Later, people who came to the East to work for military service were also called Mamluks. But why the Arab Caliphate was in need of young Turks and Caucasians? The scientist Bek Ibraev explains on the theory of his teacher, Orientalist Lev Gumilev, there is a concept known as the old ethnic group.
Старый этнос что такое? Старость как болезнь. Народ не выдает талантливых людей.
What does an old ethnic group mean? It is like a disease. The rulers become a gray personality and there is no one to replace them. No talented people are left and there is a huge number of such untalented ones. Such case was in Egypt. It was an old country. The rulers had a fear that one day people can rise against the rulers, and this was the reason they started taking strangers to their army. Children were kidnapped from Khazar Haganat and others.
Там Хазарская Ганат, все другие, они поставляли там в свое время огромное количество детей, ворованных.
It turns out that the case, which was a tragedy for Turks, was a salvation for the Arab Caliphate.
Когда египетские правители поняли, что из египтян это в основном купцы, ремесленники, мастера.
Egyptian rulers realized that there were no soldiers from Egyptians, merchants, artisans, craftsmen, but they had to defend all sorts of wealth. And rulers had a brilliant idea. Who were the best warriors? Of course, Turks were the best warriors at the time.
А кто самый лучший воин в мире? На тот момент тюрки были лучшими воинами.
They could skillfully ride and fight. Again, the Mongol army had a great force.
Опять же, монгольская армия тогда была в самой силе. Ну и вот, это было такая, если выражаться сегодняшним языком.
It was a great business idea. The rulers could buy Turkic children and raise the soldiers of Allah.
Есть тюркские дети, мы их будем покупать. И растить из них воинов Аллаха. И это совершенно уникально, это абсолютно американская голливудская идея.
This is a unique Hollywood idea. A child comes as a slave and the centuries later becomes a ruler of the country.
Это произошло не сразу, это несколько веков. Был налажен такой вот торговый.
A trading business was launched. Arabian salesmen purchased little slaves, took them to Rauda Island and made them soldiers. With the name of Allah, these soldiers started to protect the empire at the age of 14. Probably it was the first hired professional army.
И воспитывали из них воинов. И до 14 лет на выживаемость. Кто смог выжить, тот выжил. Но уже с именем Аллаха на устах они уже защищали эту империю. Это была первая, наверное, наемная профессиональная армия.
The first Turkic warriors started to serve at Caliphate in the 9th century. The most talented and successful ones changed from slaves to mercenaries, then became free men. After this, Turks became members of an influential group. The most distinguished warriors were an elite of Mamluk society.
Огромное количество людей накопились тюрков, они все разговаривали на кипчакских диалектах.
A huge number of Turks was here and they all spoke the Kipchak dialects, Kazakh, Tatar and Karachai dialects. Their owners who lived in Egypt used to sway in harems with tons of women. This is the generation of harem boys, as people say, interactive boys. All of them became such kinds of rulers. As a result, they were helpless and could not inspire people to follow them. They just could not do this. They didn't even know what the death is. Harem boys had no chance to survive in a battle with yesterday's slaves, who were warlike nomads. As history showed, the assumption of power by Kipchak origin Mamluks was stronger than the revolt of Spartacus and gladiators. In 1259, the Mamluks rebelled, killed the Sultan and proclaimed their Kipchak Ibak Sultan.
В Египте сложилась, так сказать, такая военная мужская корпорация, представленная только кипчаками.
There was a military men's corporation, Kipchak Guards, in Egypt. It was like a private men's club. Men even were not allowed to marry. If a man wanted to have a peaceful life, then he could not be a member of a particular military estate.
Запрещалось жениться. До тех пор, если ты хотел, так сказать, мирной жизни, ты мог выйти из этого состава.
When quantity of members reached a certain number, they perpetrated the coup and started to choose the ruler from among their members.
Достигло какого-то определенного числа, они совершили переворот, сместив предшествующую династию.
Kipchaks had been ruling Egypt for more than 100 years. Egypt was a country ruled by different dynasties, and Kipchaks simply continued this tradition.
Египет такая страна, которой большую частью на протяжении большей части истории, значит, управляли чужеземные династии, значит, и кипчаки в данном случае просто вписались в эту традицию.
Then Kipchaks took the power in their hands. Their rulers started to increase number of population, and so Egypt was protected by Kipchaks on all angles. Kipchak society included the sovereign's entourage, chairmen, leaders of the troops, and noblemen. By the middle of the 13th century, a new state appeared, the Mamluk Sultanate. What kind of period it was in the history of Islamic world? Why do some people believe that Kipchaks used to put yurt on the top of pyramids while others do not? Where exactly can we find Kazakh patterns in Egypt? The events described in the collection The Arabian Nights allegedly are taking place in Baghdad. Actually, the city of beauty and enigma described in this collection of stories and tales is Cairo of the Mamluks.
Государство мамлюков – это Египет и Сирия со столицей в Каире.
The land of the Mamluks was Egypt and Syria, with its capital in Cairo, and the second capital was Damascus. There is a large number of historical and architectural monuments in these capitals. They are mosques and madrasah, facilities of economic, cultural, agricultural, and military kind. Buildings of religious purpose especially shows the culture of Kipchaks.
Сооружения, архитектурные сооружения религиозного назначения, в которых отразилась именно культура кипчаков.
The Mamluks kept their native language even though they were in foreign lands. All military commands were given in Kipchak language. The Mamluks preferred to have the traditional foods of nomads.
То есть культуру кипчаков привнесли, пришли в Египет.
Kipchak culture came to Egypt through the Mamluks. This is a big Arabic-Russian dictionary. It is written based on the Egyptian dialect. Here we can meet the words like kımız, kobız, kabak, which is askabak. In translation, it means pumpkin. Soldiers used it as a target while learning archery.
Kabak – это askabak, тыква, которую стреляли из лука, учили, ну, совершенствовали навыки стрельбы из лука.
The Great Pyramid of Cheops. The sun, wind, and others affected its sharpness, and there is quite enough space to put yurt on the top of this pyramid. To put yurts on the top of pyramids is visually decorative. Could such ideas come to mind of the Mamluk rulers?
Вы там сможете сноситься? Юрты затащить можете туда?
Is it possible to take the yurt there, 200 meters height? There are stones around, and it's even difficult just to stand there. What was this for? What for?
В тех краях юрты, они, честно говоря, особо так.
The tents used by soldiers were made of black woolen fabric. This is a famous Arabian or Bedouin tent. The second fabric underneath, safe from heat. In the night, they used to sleep with removed fabric.
А ночью еще когда жара, потом прохлада спать, слегка снег поднимается, они спят так.
Здесь я с Беком согласен, потому что, опять же, это...
I agree with Beck here. It is an attractive thing. It is not possible to overlook it. Yes, this is Giza Plateau, three pyramids, and the biggest out of them is the Great Pyramid of Cheops. On the top of this pyramid, there is a platform. I couldn't get there. It is forbidden. A medium-sized yurt fits this platform. I think you can see Cairo from this top.
И на вершине этой пирамиды есть такая площадка. Я туда не смог подняться, потому что запрещают, а такой я, конечно, залез. Она как раз как будто вот сделана таким образом, что там поместится средненькая такая юрта. Наверное, с этой вершины виден весь Каир, вообще, и вообще далеко видать.
It is a really wonderful view. Researcher of Kipchak's history, Bulat Kumekov, and historian Bahitti Batyrshauli gave another interesting suggestion.
Вы обратите внимание,
Look on these patterns, which are shown in this book entitled History of Mamluks Architecture in Egypt. You can see lots of patterns which are used now in Kazakh folk arts and crafts. Most of these patterns can be seen on monuments in Egypt.
Тоже самое отразилось в Египте, их очень много, и они даже сохранились по сегодняшний день. Эти объекты можно исчислять не десятками, а сотнями.
The nomadic carving called Koshkarmuiz, in translation from Kazakh, means sheep's horns, on the Arabian monuments is a topic for further research. Surely this also will be a debate like debates about the most famous Mamluk, Sultan Baybars. What a wonderful fate did the kidnapped boy have? And how did the Mongols again face the Mamluks of Kipchak origin? In Kazakhstan, the Mamluks have been known recently. In the 1960s, Maurice Simashko wrote a novel, Emshan, dedicated to the famous man from the steppe, the ruler Baybars. He was of Kipchak origin. Baybars was kidnapped and sold into slavery. Over time, the Mamluk became a distinguished military commander and took the Egyptian throne. This extraordinary person has also attracted film directors who released a film entitled Sultan Baybars.
Основные события фильма соответствуют историческим фактам жестокого 13 века. Остальные – плод размышлений авторов, ибо из множества биографий Султана Бейбарса нет ни одной, которая бы не отвергала другую.
Я не профессиональный историк. Ну, историей мамлюков я занимался...
I'm not a professional historian, but I started studying the history of the Mamluks at university time. I have been interested in Mamluks history after talks with Maurice Simashko. He used to tell me, you, Kazakhs, are fool. If you want to connect your origin with ancient times, as every nation or ethnic group wants to, you do not need to make up facts. The Mamluks were your ancestors. Baybars was your ancestor. Maurice's famous novel Emshan was also filmed.
Вам не нужно пытаться там удревнять, создавать какие-то искусственные там события. У вас были мамлюки, у вас был Бейбарс. Ну и опять же его этот знаменитый роман «Имшан», да, по мотивам которого был снят фильм.
Baybars was a popular ruler who had defeated the Crusaders, but the most important battle was at the time the Mamluks again faced the Mongols. In 1216, Hulagu Khan's envoys arrived to Cairo with demand to surrender Egypt. The Mamluks killed them and defeated the Mongol troops at a place called Ayn Jalut. This battle is known as the Battle of Ayn Jalut. The Mongolian commander Kitbuga was captured and executed. The attack of the great Kagan army was halted and the Mamluks settled in Syria. The Mongols knew only one way to move forward, destroying everything and everyone on their way. This was the most correct way, and they were surprised when they saw the Mamluks moving forward to them. When two armies met on the battlefield near Ayn Jalut, the Mongols crashed down.
На границе между Йорданией и Израилем.
The most powerful armies met at the border between Jordan and Israel, about 30 kilometers from the Dead Sea.
И тогда схлестнулись самые сильные армии мира. Это 12 век.
The army of Mongols under the leadership of Kitbuga and the army of Mamluks. It was the decisive battle in which Mamluks defeated Mongols. Probably this was the only defeat of the Mongols in the 12th-13th centuries. Well, now we can say the soldiers of both Mongol and Mamluk armies were Turks, mostly Kipchaks.
И монгольского воина, армии, и мамлюкской армии были тюрки, в основном кипчаки.
Still, there are lots of questions connected to this battle. Why did only a small part of the great Kagan's army fight at the Battle of Ayn Jalut? Why didn't the Mamluks pay for envoy's execution? Kipchak Baybars knew that this crime was the most grievous sin in the steppe, the Mongols eradicated entire cities for such crimes.
Монголы предприняли более 7 попыток дойти до Египта и, значит, эти территории включить в состав империи. Казалось бы, ничто не могло остановить.
The Mongols made more than 7 attempts to get to Egypt and join these territories to the Great Empire. It seemed that nothing could reflect this invasion, because at the time there was no power around the world to stop the Mongolian destruction machine. Finally, the most fatal campaign. The Mongols reached Syria and were planning to advance towards to Egypt. Kipchaks were ready to rise to this challenge. Would they have won? This is a big question. Suddenly, the Mongol army stopped. The Mongolian military machine stopped, turned around and walked away. The Mongols left only the small unit with 10,000 cavalrymen.
Более того, не приняв сражения, не приняв никакого военного вызова, монгольская вся вот эта военная машина как бы замедляет свой ход, останавливается.
The Mongol army used to stop only in one case, in case of death of the great Mongol Khan. And here is the coincidence. When the military machine was moving and no one could stop it, great Monke Khan died. The military actions were stopped all over the empire. Why? What for? Because they lost their brain center. They lost a person without whom the empire could not move forward till new Khan was elected. As the election of the new Khan took much time, the Mongols never came back to Egypt.
Для чего? Потому что исчез мозговой центр, исчез, так сказать, исчезла фигура, которая, без которой, так сказать, введение военных действий империя не могла дальше осуществлять. До тех пор, пока не будет избрана новая фигура. Поскольку процесс затянулся, значит, монголы больше не вернулись в Египет.
We will never know whether Egypt was condemned to fail or was protected by a higher power. Could Sultan Baybars has kept his nickname Father of Victory if the army of the Mongol Empire had made a new attempt to conquer Egypt? It will remain a mystery. As time passed, there was a new adventure for the Mamluks. What did Napoleon offer them, and how did people of steppe origin meet again on the battlefield? Former slaves made an incredible thing. They managed to remain in power for several centuries, even partly reconciled with their enemies, the Mongols. After the Battle of Ain Jalut, Sultan Baybars developed close cooperation with one of the grandson of Genghis Khan, Khan Birke.
Ну, что важно, мамлюки, став правителями,
the Mamluks became the rulers of Egypt and fixed their power in history. The Mamluk rulers were not just obscure Desti Kipchak Khans, but they were the rulers who were in the center of Mediterranean and Mongolian diplomacy.
Которые вошли в орбиту и средиземноморской дипломатии, и монгольской.
Even after the Mamluks lost their power over Egypt, they remained to be the military aristocracy and influential political force during several centuries. In the late 18th century, Napoleon's army invaded Egypt, and this time the Mamluks were defeated by French. It is amazing thing how Bonaparte dealt with his enemies.
Мамлюкский Египет существовал почти до 19 века.
Mamluk Egypt existed almost until the 19th century. Only with the arrival of Napoleon, the Mamluk power weakened. Napoleon forced the Mamluks to join his army. He told them, "I respect you, come with me to conquer Europe." The Mamluks skillfully fought and they reached Paris.
Он-то не захватил же так военный способ, он союз заключил с Египтом и набрал этих храбрых себе в гвардию. Эта гвардия сопровождала до Парижа и все прочее, никого не предавая, рубилась насмерть.
The Mamluks became the most exotic part of French army. Being a part of the French army, they again faced their steppe brothers. In the war of 1812, Kyrgyz Kaisaks were in Russian army. French people even called them Northern Amurs. And here we can say the nomads took a kind of revenge on the Mamluks, because nomads were in Russian army who won this war. What happened to the Mamluks of Egypt at the end of their epic? One of the Egypt rulers organized a grand ceremonial procession in Cairo, to which he invited some hundreds of the Mamluks. Assembled in the citadel, they were warmly welcomed, and then the ruler commanded to kill all of the Mamluks. It is known as Massacre at the Citadel. This is how Egyptian nobility dealt with strangers. This is a sad end of the amazing destiny of Kipchak boys. They had an unusual story. Coming to the foreign country as slaves, they managed to battle the fate. They became free men, built a military career, and were on the top of power. Some of them even took the throne in the foreign country. And the most significant thing is that they do not disappear in the foreign culture. They show themselves as worthy people of the great steppe origin.